I'm good. How are you? Yep, Sarah Sakura, you got it. All right, that's very loaded, but I will do my best. So my name is Sarah Sakura. I'm actually 29 years old from Detroit, Michigan. And you might be thinking Detroit is not the hub of anything voiceover, and you're absolutely correct. But the lovely thing about voiceover is it's shifting. So currently, with a lot of non-union voiceover, especially in indie video games, you're able to do it remotely. So if you have the proper setup and knowledge of the industry, you can do it in your pajamas. So for me, I've taken full advantage of that and made a full career off it for the last 5 years. And I've been doing casting for about 2.5 or 3 years now. So that's been really fun. I mostly do indie video games, sometimes animation narration. But overall, my heart has always been kind of in the gamer world because I very much enjoy playing games every day. So I figured, why not?
Awesome. Very cool. I like how you did it kind of like a promo for voice acting from home. That was,
Pretty much.
I felt the promo voice coming out just a little bit.
Sorry.
No, it's good. It's good. I think some of the, you know, more interesting things as we're talking to, kind of more mainstream voice actors and up and coming voice actors, that's one thing that we're hearing a lot of is able to do things remote. And sometimes it's a lot more cost efficient. And games can afford to, you know, pay their voice actors better, or sometimes we've actually heard of like ensemble casting via Skype, that kind of stuff.
Yes. I actually just did that about a couple days ago. Did that live via Skype. It's actually quite an interesting experience.
Yeah, definitely. And I think for us, the guys that are watching, you know, these interviews and really appreciating voice acting from the outside, we love to see when voice actors can do things together. There's a lot of, talent out there that can do it, without having to record with anybody. I'm sure there's been several things that you've worked on where you've recorded by yourself and it sounds good. But there's just something about being able to record live with somebody else there and kind of feed off each other's energy that seems to translate well into especially video games.
Well, I was just casting for a game and I had picked my co-star with the help of the studio I'm working with. And I actually told him, like, yes, we could record separately, but for this, especially being such a high narrative game where you're having two best friends interacting back and forth, why not have us record together? So we set it up. She's in Australia. I'm in Michigan. Very big time zone difference, right. But we make work. And it was a really cool experience. I had a lot of fun getting to know her more. It's really cool having this, like, chance to be around your co-stars, because in most circumstances for non-union remote, you don't get that chance. So it is something that is greatly missed when you're not able to go to a studio, is just being able to be part of a community and having that cast bonding experience.
Very cool. Well, let's start off with, the kind of age-old question that any voice actor is going to ask anybody that's aspiring to become one. What were your steps to kind of get into the industry? What were you doing to kind of get yourself into your first, major title?
So I don't know if it's a one size fits all for everybody, but there are some general steps that I would suggest for just about anybody. Okay. For me, I had a weird experience. I never dreamed of being a voice actor. It was not a goal. I just kind of fell into it as well as for casting. I was originally a YouTuber, believe it or not, and I had 35,000 subscribers. It wasn't a lot, I had a nice little community. Yeah. And it was all around gaming. So I did a lot of horror video games that I would play on there. And sometimes I would read the notes you would find and I would do little voiceovers for them. Absolutely horrendous. But people seemed to believe that I was good enough to suggest that maybe I should try voiceover. I heard it enough to where I was like, okay, I have fellow YouTuber friends that do that stuff. So I ended up trying it. Horrendous. Awful. So The thing about voiceover that's very interesting to me is a lot of people believe that if you have a nice voice or you can do funny voices or impressions, that you can be a voice actor. The thing they seem to forget is the acting part of the voice acting. Right. So you can have the greatest voice in the world, but if you lack the acting component, you're going to fall flat. You really need to study and learn that before you can really worry about your arsenal of voices. So right. For my personal opinion, whenever I have people come up to me and ask me, how do you do that? I always suggest getting a coach, learning how to act, going to workshops, learning how to improv, doing all different things around acting. I can be in person or online. There's many different options. I do one-on-one Skype coaching with a bunch of different really great actors. I learn from them and it helps me a lot. And personally, that's how I've learned. But there's other ways to learn. Also just practicing monologues in your free time, things like that. You don't need to put a bunch of money into it right away. Just need to learn if it's right for you first. And then after that, there's a whole slew of other steps you can take. But it all depends on your and the speed that you're learning and the things you need for you and what you're setting out to do. Because voiceover at the end of the day is not so much a hobby as it is a career, and a very competitive career at that. Yeah. So you get told no quite often. If you can't handle rejection, you take that hard, that's not good for you. There's a lot of components that make voiceover into what it is in the industry, and a lot of people forget those. They just think it's a cool job with money and fame, when that's not actually the case. I put so much money into voiceover, and I've started to make quite a bit back, but for years, I was just sinking money into it. And it became very hard to keep up with that and trying to maintain my life as an adult. So it's not always glamorous. A lot of people don't know who it is voicing behind these characters, or a lot of people slam on you sometimes if you're learning and you're not doing your absolute best and you're trying to figure out how to become better. And people are like, well, this is a horrible performance from this person and they're a horrible actor, and you're just in the steps of learning. It can be really discouraging.
Definitely.
So, wow, it's a hard thing.
That was a very good answer. I think you've touched on a lot of key points, especially with the acting and the, you know, handling of rejection. Well, like I mentioned to you kind of off air, we talked a little bit about some of the other guests that we've had on, and Quentin Flynn was one of them. And he told us, an interesting story about, you know, he's a big voice actor nowadays. He's in, you know, Metal Gear and Kingdom Hearts and all of that stuff. And
he's Raiden too, right?
He is. But, you know, there was that time, you know, before he kind of made it big where he was getting rejected a lot, and he, you know, dealt with a lot of stresses and things about that. Yeah. And I think that definitely is an important thing to, you know, keep trying and keep refining and kind of honing your skills and your craft. But you in particular, I want to take a sidestep here and talk a little bit about you specifically, because like you mentioned, acting is a huge part of voice acting. It's the other part of the voice part. And the roles that you've kind of chosen to voice or, you know, have been cast in, they're not the easiest ones. Horror is something that's very tough to do on your initial kind of like entry, and you have a lot of horror games under your belt so far. Tell me what it was like for you to do kind of your one of your first horror games, whichever one that might have been. Which one for you was kind of the kind of click moment where you were like really felt that genre and it was kind of believable and accepting for your own performance?
Well, there's different variations of things. The very, very first, I would say, was The Crow's Eye, but it wasn't your typical horror. It was more of a psychological kind of adventure thriller kind of situation with some puzzles mixed in. It was probably the first video game I ever did several years ago. And I played Dr. Evelyn, and she was not your scary type. She was more of just this mysterious kind of like angry, mean kind of character, but not so directly.
Right.
So she kind of just toyed with you and had this kind of persona about her that was, for lack of a better word, sort of bitchy. And so that was kind of her major dynamic. And that was a very cool experience. It was scary for me because it was the first video game, but it actually was received pretty well, and I was very proud of it. To this day, I have it on my resume, even though it's maybe not my best performance. It was a very critical part of my voiceover journey. So, and for that reason, I've kept it there. But I would say one of the biggest ones that one of the big changing points for me was probably, I want to say, The Beast Inside, when I did the demo for Emma.
Right.
That one was more than I had done in some capacity because my character was tied to a chair with a murderer ready to kill her. And there was just something different about that role that I had not really done yet, which was this like terrifying, gut-wrenching fear. I've done characters that were fearful before, but it's a little different when you have a dude with a, like an axe or a knife hanging over your head ready to get you, you know? Right. So that was a very cool experience for me. And I knew from the get-go that, because personally, as a gamer, horror games have always been one of my favorite genres to date, and I have always loved them. The experience is so immersive and sometimes real. Like, you just feel so scared, truly scared in moments. It's fun. So being able to kind of bring that alive was really cool. I did another game called Hollow pretty early on, which I believe I'm doing Hollow 2. I think they're working on that. Maybe I'll come back.
Fingers crossed.
We'll see. But I was able to play a character named Sarah, who was a bit of a psychotic person who was going through a lot of emotional trauma and dealing with things, and in certain parts transformed into other versions of herself, which was really fun in itself, too, because I recently just did another role like that. And I'm not going to talk about that one yet. But there was just, there's something cool about being able to portray a character's downfall. Like a traumatic event, and you have to really sell those really emotional moments, because if you don't, they're going to fall flat. So you have to kind of, I don't know, there's been times I was in the booth where I just came out without being able to speak, because I had to do so many, have to do so many takes of things, right? You don't just do a line once. So if there's a screaming line where you're screaming your head off that you're dying, well, you're doing that more than once.
You need 3 to 5 at least.
Yeah. So there's usually an A, B, and C take, generally, if not more. So it's like you're giving your all at each take, and it's like, that's just one line. You have a whole script, and it's tiring, and it's sometimes draining, but I really do love what I do. And I think for me personally, my favorite thing to voice, even though it tears my vocal cords apart, my favorite thing.
Yeah, definitely a good voice that you have in the horror genre. We spoke, you know, a little bit about the Beast Inside demo where you played Emma, and I'd like to kind of walk you through that and talk about that a little bit, because that game, you know, it definitely got some press and some publicity for its demo. I know a lot of YouTubers covered it. We covered it. I don't think I've kind of explained that to you, but on the side we do a game news review site as well, and these interviews kind of go on there as well. So we checked that out, and originally we had got just a gameplay trailer, and I don't think the gameplay trailer had you in it. I think it was mainly just the guy, whoever's voicing the main character, and it looked like, it looked kind of cheesy. I was like, oh man, it's going to be one of those games where you walk around, there's nothing to do. And then the opening car ride for that demo, you guys, I don't know, did you guys do that together, or was that separate?
No, that was separate.
Okay. There's some banter back and forth between your two characters, and it felt really natural, and I kind of got engaged to those two characters. I was like, oh, okay, you know, they're like a regular couple. It didn't sound weird. It didn't sound forced. It sounded like you guys were having a car ride together. So big props to him as well.
He's a fabulous voice actor. I love working with him. I got to work with him on several video games so far.
Very cool.
And every single time it's like, we're kind of like, whether he's my boyfriend or dad in a game, it's always just such a cool mix. I really enjoy it. He's done a lot of really cool stuff.
Yeah, and I think that really kind of played into it, and then getting, you know, to that house, and just like, a lot of times you don't get that casual interaction in games, and this one kind of setting up the horror story wanted to do a more casual thing, and I just, the banter between you guys sounded great. Tell me about recording something like that, to go from that kind of fun-loving kind of stuff. How do you kind of play that so it doesn't sound fake? That's a big thing that we see in a lot of, you know, indie games or voice actors that are maybe trying a little too hard, and it comes off as just something like unconvincing. For you was kind of the driving force?
When you do a conversational tone, the best thing to do is make it as real as you can. Pretend you're talking to a friend. You know, you don't want to overdo it. You don't want to oversell it, but you also don't want to do it too reserved to where it falls flat again. So you have to find this middle ground where it's just genuine. The best way to do that is think about, you're talking directly, that microphone is your friend. You're talking to your friend. The subtle changes in a voice, the inflections, a little intake of breath, a pause, really does a lot to bring a script alive rather than just staring at it and reading it straight through. So I personally, I try not to look at the script when I record. Okay. I try to memorize the line and then just give it in an organic way. And if I don't read it verbatim from the script, that's okay. It's sometimes better to just sound more natural coming out of someone's mouth to give them that more real feel. Because a lot of people are just married to a script. They see, you know, there's this punctuation here. I got to follow that. Not always. Sometimes you have to take actor liberties. If a client will let you, you really should, especially in character work, where you want to make this character your own. You don't necessarily want to just be staring at a script, a piece of paper, and just reading it. You want to act it.
Okay, very cool. Now, when you're doing voice work for video games specifically, for maybe something like The Beast Inside, are you visually picturing like scenes? Do you have that kind of stuff available to you? Like, how do you handle the setting for these things? Because talking to somebody, you know, in a car may be different than talking to them, you know, out across an open field. So how do you kind of determine what your tone's going to be like and how you're going to approach how you're speaking?
What's interesting about that is most indie companies are not very resource friendly. So they don't necessarily always give you the right context. Sometimes you have to guess. So there's plenty of times that I'm working on games and I have a script and it's very bare. I have the dialogue of just my character or I have the dialogue of the people in the scene. Sometimes there is no context. I don't know where they are. I don't know how they're feeling. I don't know the mood. I don't know anything. There's other times I've been given actual visuals. I've been given the mocap of the scene. I've been given animations of the scene. I've been given concept art. I've been given a lot. So it really depends. But more times than not, I'm given a very bare script. So that's part of it, is being able to, which I, in a way, think being a writer has helped me greatly with that, because I've published some fantasy novels and that kind of sort of stuff. Okay. So for me, I kind of am used to envisioning worlds and these characters and dialogue. So I think that's helped me kind of get into the world, even if I don't have all the pieces there for me. And if you ever need help, you can always just ask. You know, you can tell them, I need a little bit more information on this. I'm a little confused what to do here. Worst case scenario, you send it in. It doesn't match. They tell you to do a pickup. You redo it with the new information given. But overall, most times, I just give an A, a B, and a C take, which are different emotions attached.
Okay.
So hoping I hit one.
Makes sense. All right, so to close up our Beast Inside talk, I want to cover the horror scene of that game that we kind of talked about a little earlier. Your character, you know, tied to a chair, about to be killed. What was that like for you? You know, recording that and kind of walk me through your mindset, because it's like you mentioned, it's very different. And yes. If the tone is even just a little off in that scene, it will kill the whole scene, especially with the way that they animated everything and the fact that you can like see your character. It might have been different if it was like an all black screen, but you have actual visuals going on yes. here. And if it's just off a little bit, it can turn terrible. But you really nailed that. And I think a lot of people that played the game really loved that scene in particular. So walk me through that from your point of view.
I literally kind of played it out as it was happening. I knew she was in a chair. I knew her hands were tied. That was information I did have. So I envisioned myself in my chair doing that, in that position where somebody is trying to kill me. And I just, you're crying out for help, you know, your final moments, you know, something's about to happen. You're just desperate. So I tried to bring that desperation to her that I felt she would have in that situation. And I did many takes hoping that it would be the best possible version. And I even wanted to re-record that scene before the demo came out, mm-hmm. but the company wanted to keep it as is because they really liked what I did. So, because I had done that with a little bit lesser quality equipment at the time, because it was recorded right. quite a long time ago.
Yeah.
Now I have a full on booth and everything. Before I didn't. So now I've just, I don't know. I'm really glad with how it came together. They did really, I always say, it doesn't matter how good your audio is sometimes if a company doesn't know what to do with it. So if they don't know how to yeah. properly implement it into a game, and that includes the audio engineering side, they just took my audio and turned it into something else. They did such an amazing job. I'm so happy with how it turned out. I'm very thankful for that. They're very talented over there. So yeah. that was really cool to see.
Definitely. And I think one of the last points on that is when you're doing a scene that involves kind of that kind of intensity, that, you know, that dire situation for whatever character you happen to be playing, What's your approach to making it not sound, as realistic as it maybe should? If you're thinking about, something like that happening in real life, you're screaming at the top of your lungs, you're not going
Yeah.
for the quality of, the voice work. How was that balancing act for you, finding the proper tone from, a video game person, as opposed to maybe somebody who might be experiencing something like that in real life?
Well, you want them to be able to understand you, right? So if I'm too inconsolable and you can't understand my words, they're all jerbled up, Like you can't have that. So you have to be able to have your words understood, even with subtitles added. It's so important that they can hear you, as well as bringing that emotion forward without being something that's ear piercing to the audience. You don't want them to be like cringing that the noise is just awful to hear. So you have to kind of find this middle ground. You're screaming, yes, you're just completely erratic, but you have to sound pleasant at the same time. I don't know how to tell you how to do that.
Could
That
be a
I
few
don't even
steps back from the
understand.
mic kind of thing.
I turn the volumes quite low because you got to be careful of peaking. So when you do a loud scene like that, you want your levels low, because if you, a lot of people that are newer don't understand the audio engineering side of voiceover, but as someone that does non-union, that's a big part of the job sometimes. So you kind of have to learn how to play with your decibel levels and learn how to make it sound pretty, make it sound clear, make it sound clean, and also make sure that you're doing the right job. If you're meant to sound nasty, still sound nasty, but have that audio clean. So it's a weird balancing act. But now I would say for me, when I did that scene, I just made sure that I was the careful distance away from the microphone and had the volumes the correct level and made sure it sounded good even at the highest points. Because some of it I was more quiet and some of it I was more loud throughout the, because it was a one solid take. I also did not want to have it be pieced up. Sometimes I do pieced up bits, but for something with heavy breathing, you can hear that in the cuts, so you kind of can't cut that up. So I made sure that I did a solid like monologue take for that.
Very cool. Well, that was awesome and definitely insightful. Before we move out of video games, because you do have some animation stuff that I want to touch on before we close out for the day, and then also, like we mentioned earlier at the beginning of the interview, you also do casting, so we definitely want to touch on that. But I'd be remiss if I didn't talk about Visage a little bit. Tell me a little bit about that story and how that game came to pass for you.
Well, I know a lovely casting director, and she was casting for a game that had no title, no nothing. I had no artwork, nothing attached to it to know it was Visage. But I had been following Visage previously, so I was already excited to play that game long before I was cast in it. And so I was trying out for a role of some kind of ghoul. And they really liked it, and I ended up getting cast for it. And then for months into recording, I did not know what the game was. They sometimes don't tell you. And this was one of those situations that I had no clue I was envisaged, even when I was recording for them.
It's
And
very
then when I did
awesome.
find out, I had the NDA silencer on me for over a year and a half, almost 2 years, I think. It was a while. I was not able to talk about it at all. So that was quite harsh. But I got cast in a role, and then I turned up to be someone else. I actually voiced Lucy. That was not the character I was cast as. So I had a lot of surprises along the way. I also
Sounds like
voiced the
it.
child in the intro scene. If you remember the intro scene with him shooting people in a chair, I was the child. I had to put a towel in my mouth for that role. That was quite interesting. So I got to play two pretty early on roles. The game just now got its next chapter, but the first chapter, the only one that was available for a very long time, was Lucy's chapter. So the little girl that has no jaw, that chases you around and breathes at you, was me.
Well, I think you nailed that, and that really just kind of goes to your credit to show you can do voice stuff like with The Beast Inside. You can do the more calm and controlled type of horror like the one we talked about in the beginning, and then you can do these kind of crazy character like creatures and things like that. So definitely good range for you there. Something you mentioned while you were speaking was the fact that you didn't know what the project was, and that's something that we hear a lot here, especially since we interview a lot of mainstream title voice actors. We spoke to a guy who is the male voice for Ryder in Mass Effect. Who literally did almost the entire thing and only found out it was Mass Effect at the very end because in the script they had used a Mass Effect term that that he recognized since he played. So that's something I'd like to touch on real quick, because I think a lot of up-and-coming voice actors that maybe watch our show kind of get off-put by the fact that they're maybe not told everything up front and, you know, and all that kind of stuff disclosed for them. They want all the information. They want to know who they're playing, what game it is, that kind of thing. Tell us about that from maybe a casting side. You can go in there and kind of explain, you know, why that's like that and, you know, how people should handle it if all the information isn't given to them up front.
So I'm actually casting for quite a few right now, and I do withhold the name of the games as well. There's a few reasons for this. I'm currently casting for a couple studios that I would say are a bit on the middle ground, the kind of that weird middle ground between indie and AAA. And I don't really want them to get bombarded with, you know, people soliciting themselves, whether it be for acting or other things. So part of the reason I hide their identity is because of that alone, to give them the ability to stay kind of hidden from the masses, because they're not ready for anything else. They don't want a ton of press. They don't want a ton of attention. They're just trying to get their ducks in a row. And also because I know a lot of actors will see there's a female voice actor we're looking for, we're casting for, but all the males are like, okay, let me send them my demo. I've already got a slew of that going on in my email currently. And I don't want that to happen to them. Yeah. So I kind of keep them protected from that. And as soon as we have everything recorded, handled, ready to go, then we kind of let people in on what's going on. We're not trying to deceive people. We're just trying to keep things under wraps. So I do understand why companies do that sometimes. I think there's a certain level of it happening at AAA level that's a bit shady, because there was the entire thing going on with the voiceover strike back in the day. Which I think some of that going on was unfair, where they weren't telling people. And I think that that kind of hurt their ability to negotiate rates and things like that.
Yes, definitely.
Because you're working on these giant games, multi-million dollar games, you don't understand.
Right, exactly.
You're accepting these low pays, and you're like, okay, well, why am I getting pennies when you're getting so much? So, I understand why in a higher level it would be problematic. However, at a lower indie level, we're giving standard rates as is. We're not going below anything standard. So everybody's getting fair pay. We're working on very minimal budgets. Some people don't have as much funding as those companies. They're newer starter companies. So for us, it's just really just trying to keep our ducks in a row. But I do understand the gripe with some people having for those situations.
Well, touching back on Visage before we get fully into that side of the interview, tell me what it was like for you for the time span. That's another thing I hear a lot from upcoming voice actors, and I deal with this myself. As I mentioned, I do an audiobook as well, and you know, it seems to me that there may be kind of like a misconception with some voice actors that when you do a role, like, then it's just like instantly produced, or you know, it's all done as soon as you give your last line. Tell me what it was like working on a game that, you know, that you worked on for some time, then maybe wasn't out as soon as you were done recording your last line. And how can upcoming voice actors kind of deal with the fact that they might not be seeing like immediate results from their work?
Well, I would say if you ever have issues with patience, you should never get into video game voiceover, because boy, there are years sometimes where you don't hear much. And I've had projects I worked on that I got paid for. We did all of our lines, and then they were never finished. The reality is sometimes things just don't pan out, or they take a lot longer. There's more hiccups than they anticipated. And it's just part of it, especially with indie studios. Sometimes they bite off more than they can chew, or problems just arise, and you have to adapt. And sometimes there are things that I just wish would happen, that I wish these projects would come out, that I know just never will. And it hurts, but it's reality. There's nothing you can do about it. I would definitely say it's not for the impatient actor.
Okay. So now let's shift a little bit into the other side of kind of what you do. Let's talk about casting. So you mentioned earlier about casting for some games and how we keep the names kind of off the books. What for you is the biggest kind of difference and kind of upbeat thing from doing casting from, you know, voiceover? What about casting to you is interesting and fun?
well, I really like getting to take all my voiceover knowledge and use that in a different way. So now I'm working with actors, helping actors complete their job, kind of being the middleman between the actor and the company. I like being in the entire process. I like being more involved in the dev world. So for me, it's just, it's an entire win-win. There are downsides to voiceover, but to me, I find no downsides with casting. I really do enjoy it. It's something that I've been doing a little bit more as of the last couple of months. Casting also just fell into my lap. I actually was cast as a leading role in Bloody Chronicles, which is a visual novel made out in by a company out in Japan. And they cast me kind of last minute as a replacement, and because the role was quite long. Mm-hmm. So the previous actor could not take it on. And boy, was it long. It took me over a year to record that character.
Oh, wow.
It was the longest thing I've ever done. But it was really cool, and it's out now. So if you want to play Bloody Chronicles, check it out. But Igrisel was really cool. They really liked me. They liked my moxie, I guess. And they decided to ask me if I knew how to cast. And I was honest. I said, no, but I'm totally open-minded. So we did kind of a trial run. And I learned through them on how to do that. Now I'm like a permanent member on their casting team. They have a casting director that does the Japanese voices, and then they have me for the English side. So I've become a permanent member for them, and I've also began doing a bunch of other things for other companies. I had the people over that did Overload, this great team that worked on amazing stuff, decided to come to me and ask if I was willing to help them cast. And more projects were coming to me because people saw that I was very involved in this community. And I have a bit of a following, especially with newer actors or actors similar to myself, and people that kind of, in a way, kind of follow or look up to me, one of the two or both. I don't know. But people do come to me quite a bit for things. So it's really cool to be this kind of like mentor, a soft mentor, helping other people out and being able to use that to also get them work. And it's just a really nice community, to be honest. The entire online non-union community for voiceover is really friendly, really helpful, and a lot of people kind of just help each other out with getting jobs and getting the information needed and supporting each other. So being able to bring all this together full circle and help make other people's dreams a reality, as well as working on my own, I really do like, as I said before, being part of the dev experience, being behind the scenes more, being more hands-on than I am when I'm just an actor. So when you're an actor, there's very little you're doing on the actual game aside from the script. So for me, it's cool to be a part of the bigger picture. And I just really love the experience.
Yeah, I think, you know, you mentioned the voice acting community, and that's, I think, where I originally kind of met you. I think it was a Facebook group. And I was looking for, you know, these kind of, up and coming non-union actors and, just different people to talk to. And, unfortunately it took us a long time to kind of connect. We had the audio book and we did a bunch of, mainstream stuff towards the end of the last year. But I was sitting back and I was thinking, you know, what can we do for this show to bring it more down to earth? You know, because when we're interviewing people, you know, like David Hayter, Troy Baker, Steve Downs, you kind of lose touch with what it means to come up as a voice actor and do all this this work that you're doing. You know, you're voice acting, you're doing animation, narration, the games, casting. Like, that's a grind, and I definitely respect you for doing that. When you're doing casting in particular, are you doing additional like read-ins for your voice actors? What's kind of your approach for getting the audio like recorded?
So it depends. I have a philosophy where I do like an actor to record in their own element, whichever way that is preferred. If they want live directing, if they want a more involved experience with recording, they want more people there, I'm fine with that. But if they prefer being in their own bubble and recording by themselves, I also respect that. As long as we're getting the quality that we're after, as long as they're performing to their best, I don't really care how they do it. It's up to them. And there have been times where I've had to step in and kind of do some live directing. And it's a cool experience any way that they want to do it. For me, I just really prefer the actor to be at their best. So I also try to support them in whatever way that they need. If they have questions, concerns, I'm 24/7 available for them. And that's kind of another part of it, is kind of being like a customer support, if you will.
There you go. I like that.
It's kind of like that. But again, it's another enjoyable thing for me. I like making sure that everybody is treated fair, the dev as well as the actor. Because me being an actor myself, I know sometimes there's things lost in translation. Right. Sometimes devs don't understand certain things about voice actors that I kind of put in check. I'm like, well, we can't do this because of this, you know? So I kind of keep things in the balance to make sure both teams are winning out.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much. We're going to close up with something I ask every voice actor, big, small, medium, whatever the case is. We like to give a kind of voice actor tip at the end of the interview to put it in perspective or context. We've had voice actors like Rena Wilson who gave a tip to chew a green apple peel before you record and it'll get rid of the sticky sound in your mouth. Or Quentin Flynn suggests that you definitely go to do like workshops and improv is a big one for him. What's something that you would suggest people do to kind of, you know, have a something in the back of their mind that they can go to that'll help improve their voice acting? It can be quirky. It can be a, you know, common thing.
Can I say a couple quick ones?
Sure. Why not?
Well, one, if you're in the booth, stay hydrated. And as a lot of people have been telling me recently, wear as minimal clothing as possible because it's really hot in there and you don't want to have a heat stroke. And I've been really suffering from that lately. So if you are recording in a booth, please be careful. If you're more of a newer person and you're just getting started, then you need to understand what I kind of said earlier, that the voice is not as important early on as the acting. Please take heart that the acting is what's going to get you far at the start. So if you're a great actor, don't try to imitate other people. I've seen so many people like try to do Joker impressions or other things. You are your own person. Understand who you are and give it out there to the world. Don't try to be someone else.
Definitely. I think that's great advice. If you do a good Joker impression, that might make me laugh, but maybe not what a studio is looking for.
No, so. I've seen so many people fall from that. It's like, please, you got to be yourself. That's right. Why they're hiring you.
Exactly. Well, thank you so much for talking to me today. I definitely appreciate it. We've learned a lot. Got a good bunch of information from you. Now it's shameless plug time. So please go ahead and tell us where people can follow you. If you'd like people to follow you on like social media, if you've got a project that you're working on that you'd like to talk about, or if there's like a game or something that somebody that just wants to know more about you or learn more about you, what's like the kind of go-to game? Give us some plugs here.
So I would say the best way to learn anything about voiceover or even be involved in my future casting calls is just go to my Twitter, which is Sarah Sikora VO. And the only other thing that I truly use a lot is, I guess, my Instagram, which is sarah.sikora. I just post a lot of stuff about my life and voiceover. So if you're into those things.
Definitely. We'll put a link in the description down below for both of those sites. And if somebody wanted to check out something that you were in, what's your kind of go-to project? What's your, like, this is me kind of thing?
You can go to sarahsikora.com. I guess that's the best way to see what I'm currently involved in. Or just like my Twitter, I always post stuff on there about current projects. But yeah, mostly if you like horror games, you'll probably see me or hear me in those in the near future.
Okay, definitely. Yeah, we can post a link to that to your website as well. That is a great one. She's got a nice resume on there. The site's real clean and easy. That's another tip for you voice actors. If you're going to get a site, make sure it's easy to navigate. I've been on some to try and schedule these interviews, and I get lost and I end up in depths of YouTube.
The small little thing to add is if you like my website, my boyfriend actually makes them for voice actors. So there, if you want one, hit me up.
Yeah, we got the hookup for voice actor websites here.
Yep.
Again, Sarah, thank you so much for joining me. Thank you guys for watching The Codec today. Sarah, anything you'd like to say before I let you go?
Nope, that's about it.
All right. Thank you guys for watching, and we'll see you next time on The Codec.